In this video, we're going to go through the different features of the ID Mixer that controls ID44. If you want information on a particular section of the ID Mixer, then go to the video description for the timestamps of the different sections. Simply put, the ID Mixer is the control center for your ID interface, enabling you to customize monitoring, functionality, and settings to make ID44 suit your workflow. The channel section displays your analog and digital inputs, as well as your door returns, or in other words, the audio coming back from your digital audio workstation or computer. The master section contains the cue mixes and the monitor controls. Then finally, you have the system panel, which enables you to control your routing and other settings. We will look at the routing options available in more detail later in this video. On a Mac, double-click on the ID app in your application menu. This will create a menu bar item in the top right of the screen. The mixer window should then open so long as your unit is connected. If you close the mixer window, you can reopen it at any time by clicking on the ID icon and selecting Show Mixer. On Windows, click the ID app in the application menu. This will create an ID icon in the system tray. Right-clicking on this will allow you to open the mixer window and adjust ID44's settings such as sample rate and buffer size. So the channel section is what you will use to build your main and queue mixes. These are terms from mixing consoles, where the main mix refers to the full mix that you, the engineer, would be listening to, and the queue mix, which refers to a separate customized mix, typically used to send to artists when recording. Making use of the main and queue mixes on ID44 means you're able to create completely separate headphone mixes for the artists you're recording. There are three kinds of channels: mic channels, digital channels, and door returns. And these individual types can be hidden using these channel toggle buttons in the master section to help keep things tidy. The four mic channels show you the signal from the mic and line inputs, as well as the instrument inputs. The digital channels show you the signal from the optical inputs. And the door returns display the audio coming back from your computer, where the ID44 output in your door will correspond to the door return channel. For example, output 1 and 2 will go to door 1 and 2, and output 3 and 4 will go to door 3 and 4. This will come in handy when sending out separate artist mixes or processing audio with outboard gear. At the top of each channel is a customizable channel name. You can double-click on this and type the name that you want to help organize your mixer app. Once named, if you forget the input type, you can hover over the channel toggle buttons and the type of input will appear under the name. On the analog and digital input channels, a polarity reverse button can be found below the naming strip for dealing with phase issues caused from using multiple microphones. Next up, you have the pan controls to position your signal in the stereo field. You also have the stereo grouping button, letting you control the levels of a stereo source by grouping together two adjacent channels. The solo and mute buttons allow you to quickly isolate channels, which can be useful if you want to check that a particular input is sounding good without any distraction from other sources. Finally, you have the meter and the fader. The meter displays the DBFS value, which is the level that comes into your computer. If the input is set too loud, the peak LED will light up, meaning you have clipped your converters and could end up with some bad sounding distortion. We recommend setting your levels so that at the loudest point you're peaking at about -10 dB. The fader is used to set the monitoring level of a channel for the particular mix you're working on. When you turn up one of the input channels, you're actually making use of the ultra-low latency monitoring, letting you listen to your inputs without any delay. To quickly zero a fader, you can hold Alt or Option on a Mac and click on the fader cap. In the master section, you are able to toggle between the different mixes: your main mix, typically used for your speaker output, and the cue mixes, generally used for creating headphone mixes for your artist when you're recording. Simply click on the mix you want to edit, and adjust the faders and pans on any channels you want to hear. If you want to preview a cue mix to hear what your artist will be hearing, you can hit the solo button in the cue window. You can also adjust the master level of the cue mix here too. The meters will show you the overall level of the cue mix, and the chronometer along the bottom will show you the level over the last 20 seconds, so you can see that the audio is being sent, and you can also keep an eye out for clipping. Next, we have the monitor control buttons. Here you have a number of different functions that can be used to help improve your workflow in the studio: dim, cut, alt speaker, talkback, polarity, and mono. Alt speaker will switch to use an alternate set of outputs. This can be configured in the system panel, but is typically used if you have two sets of speakers and want to quickly switch between them. The talkback button opens up a line of communication with the engineer and the artist, either using one of the mic inputs on ID44, any mic connected to your computer, or even your computer's built-in mic input. This is configured in the system panel. The mono button will sum the stereo mix bus into a mono signal, which is useful for checking if your mix will sound good on mono sources such as mobile devices. The polarity button will flip one side of the stereo field whilst also activating mono, using phase cancellation to cancel out the center of the stereo signal and playing only the sides. This is a great way to get mix inspiration by removing the center pan signals in existing records, or to check the sides of your own mixes and make sure that any reverbs and delay tails are sounding as good as they can. As well as the software buttons, there are dedicated buttons on ID44 to cut and dim the speaker output, which will temporarily mute or lower the level of the output while retaining your preferred listening level, perfect for having a quick word with someone in the studio. You can control how much the dim lowers the level in the system panel. Each of the non-dedicated monitor controls can be assigned to one of the physical function buttons by right-clicking and selecting the function button you want to assign it to. This gives quick and flexible access in the middle of a session. The system panel is where you can change most of the inner workings of ID44. On the left-hand side, you have the digital settings. Here, you can select the digital protocol you want to use for the digital inputs and outputs, either ADAT or SPDIF. Below is the preferred clocking source for use when you're using a digital input. When using ID44 on its own, or when setting ID44 as the master clock, you can leave this set to internal. However, when wanting to slave ID44 off an external device, you can select the preferred source here. If the indicator is red, then this indicates that there is no clock signal on the input. This could be because a cable isn't connected or the wrong digital protocol is being used. A yellow indicator shows that a valid clock is available, but the sample rate doesn't match the current sample rate of ID44. A green indicator means that a valid clock source is present on that input and is at the correct sample rate, so you're ready to record. For information on clocking and setting up ID44 with digital equipment, please click the card in the top right of this video to find out more. Below this, you have the mono mode, letting you adjust which output is used during mono summing, either the left or right speaker individually, or both at the same time. Finally, at the bottom, you have the trim controls, where you can adjust the amount the outputs are reduced when you activate dim, and where you can adjust the level of your alt speaker outputs so that they sound consistent when you switch between speakers. And now we move on to the routing panel. The sources are displayed horizontally along the top, and the outputs are vertically on the left. To route the signal, click the button that lines up with both the source and the destination that you want. By default, the main mix is routed to analog outputs 1 and 2, which means that everything you've turned up in main mix will be sent to your main speaker outputs 1 and 2. The second set of line outputs are set to alt speaker by default, which means that when you press the alt speaker button, this output will switch to play your main mix. By default, the headphones are set to main mix, playing exactly the same thing that comes out of your speaker outputs. However, if you have built a low latency monitoring mix for an artist on one of the cue mixes and you want to send it to the headphones, you would select the appropriate cue mix for the headphone output. Door through allows you to directly route signal from your door to a physical output, bypassing all routing and volume controls. This is useful if you have a separate monitor controller, for example, or you want to send audio out to a piece of outboard gear at full volume. You'll need to be careful of using door through on your speaker outputs, as it will send full volume audio to your speakers, which might not be very pleasant. You will get a warning explaining this every time you select it, just in case you press it by mistake. This helps prevent damaging your speakers. You can set the outputs to mono by pressing the stereo button on the left. This will allow you to choose different sources for each individual mono output. This is useful if you want to send two different mono signals to different pieces of outboard gear from outputs 3 and 4, for example. The routing matrix works exactly the same for the digital outputs as it does for the analog outputs. By default, the digital outputs are all set to door through, meaning you can send signal out of outputs 9 and 10 in your door, and it would send it to the first two channels of the first digital output. The other tab in the routing panel is the talkback tab, where you can select the input that you will be using for your talkback source. This is your way of staying in contact with an artist by speaking directly into their headphones. Here you have the option to use one of ID44's inputs, whether analog or digital, or you have the ability to use an external source, which could be your computer's built-in mic or even a USB microphone. When a talkback source is selected, that channel will turn into a talkback channel in the ID Mixer window. An external source will come in on door return 10. A talkback channel can be identified by its solo and mute buttons changing into a talkback button, which will trigger the talkback. By default, the talkback channel will be routed to all of the cue mixes ready to be sent to your artist headphones. Once you've set up the ID mixer just how you want it, you can save it as a preset so you can quickly recall all your settings. To save a current setup, simply go to File, then Save. You can now give the configuration a name to remember it by and click Save. You can also export the configuration to send to friends or collaborators, or to store along with your project file. To recall a preset, simply go to File and then click Open. A list of your previously saved presets will appear. Choose the one that you wish to use and click Load. The mixer will now change to that particular preset. If you plan on using ID44 away from a computer, then you can save a preset directly to ID44 itself, known as a standalone state. Great for complex monitoring mixes out on the road. To do this, simply go to the Setup menu and select Store Standalone State. The current configuration of the mixer will then be saved into ID44's memory. The mixer app always takes preference over the standalone setting, so if the app is loaded and the unit is connected, then the standalone setting will be replaced. Occasionally, we will release firmware updates for ID44 to add new features or to maintain compatibility with new operating system releases. The ID Mixer app will prompt you to update when any major updates are released by us. To manually ensure that your ID44 is running the latest version of firmware, simply go to the Help menu and select Check for Updates. The ID Mixer application will check if any updates are available, and if so, will prompt you to install them. Here, simply follow the process through. We hope this video has given you an idea of the capabilities and powerful features of the ID Mixer, and that you find it a useful tool to add to your workflow. For more information about ID44 or the ID app, please look at the product manual on our website or have a look at some of our other videos. If you found this video useful, please give it a like and don't forget to subscribe for more ID44 related news and video content.